Okay, well, thank you for introduction, and thank you very much for inviting me. And it's always a pleasure to come here first, but also it's very stimulating. It's, you know, a very diverse set of things, and I think that they're pushing certainly the edges of my knowledge, but at things that I think the real opportunities to get at. And in a way, I'm going to talk about things also at the edge of my what I can know about. But there's an enormous amount, you know, life exists in complex mixtures, and it's great that people are getting at that in all sorts of ways and connecting it to the molecular biology end of things. So so I've worked in genome sequencing one way or another for like 30 years, and I feel very lucky to have done so, because it's been a tremendous time for that. But people keep thinking it's over. I mean, in fact, you know, I remember at the end of the Human Genome Project, everybody said, "Oh, well, we've done that, and now we're going to do post-genomics." Actually, we don't hear the word post-genomics so often nowadays, though it was very fashionable 20 years ago. So it's a transformative technology for biology, I think, and we should recognize we're still in the middle of that development. And in a way, what I'm going to talk about today is just how we can push the edges of what we can do with sequencing. And that's not going to be the end of things either. It's just new approaches. So I think of there being as three phases. They're really driven by technology. The first one was automating the Sanger sequencing. And that led to the reference genomes for human and mouse and flies and yeast and worms and a few other things, and was very important. Gave us a sort of picture of the finiteness of the world of genes, for example, that before we didn't know how many there were, we just were fishing them out. Then phase two was driven by the short read technologies that we now still continue to use and that dominate modern sequencing, and allowed population resequencing, took variation, and also very critically, genomic assay by sequence. We can get at, you know, RNA-seq and ChIP-seq and ATAC-seq and all sorts of designed experiments where sequencing is a readout, because it's an incredibly data-rich and, you know, efficient biological readout. And then there's a new phase, which is really just growing now still, although it's actually about 10 years old technically, of single molecule sequencing. And people think about that as long read sequencing, but actually the critical thing is not so much that it's long read, but it's that you're sequencing, you know, single molecules, and you're sequencing the native molecule. It's not amplified or changed. So you can see modifications on it. You can get it in the form which it existed in, wherever you got it from. And that's, you know, that's really what you want to do. So I think the opportunities there are enormous for clever use of that. We can look directly at DNA molecules. So I would say we're still learning how to use phase two, despite all the wonderful things that people do, many of which we've heard of, and we're at the start of phase three. So, you know, what's driving all this? Well, information technologies scale exponentially. And actually, Eric talked about a sort of insight from Sydney Brenner. And I remember hearing him, and Nathan Myhrvold was the CTO of Microsoft. And at some point they teamed up together and they went on a world tour, where they gave lectures full of Sydney witticisms. And but they made this point that sequencing is basically an information technology, and it's the only things you can't scale exponentially, the rate of make, you know, reduce the cost of a car exponentially, or you know, physical things, but things that are based on information do that over very long time periods. So if we look at sequencing, you know, over the last 30 years or so, we've gone, you know, from a pound a base to 10 to the minus 7 pounds, dollars or whatever units, monetary units, a base pair. And that's about, it's more than twofold a year. 2 to the 3 or 2 to the 10 is about 1,000. So 2 to the 30, you know, is 10 to the 9. So it's about twofold a year for two decades. It's faster than Moore's law. And that actually has a direct consequence that the computational side, I've been working in computational genomics mainly, which is very intimately linked to genomics all around. But we have to get cleverer or do something different every few years, because otherwise we can't keep up. The computers couldn't keep up. Okay, so I think this exponential scaling of technology demands we're ambitious. We should think, what can we do with it? And so how can we use sequencing to learn about organisms and their environment? That's in a way the topic of the meeting. So how can we use sequencing to do that? So, you know, the two things I would argue are that we should enable genomics for all of life. And at the moment, you know, there's a huge concentration of genomics in humans and model organisms, basically. And people have been reaching out. There are all these new model systems. And we hear about, we've heard all sorts of things in the meeting, but people are always wanting, you know, references and resources, and there's infrastructure involved. We should aim to produce, just as the infrastructure for the human genome, it was important to get completion. I think we should aim to get a complete infrastructure for genomics for life. I'll come to that later. But I think we can also use environmental sequencing to monitor life and to examine life in the wild. And I'm going to talk about that. And although I've talked about bits of this before, I haven't put all this together in quite the same way. So we'll see how it goes. So we can sequence environmental DNA. It's been mentioned a few times. But mostly what we've heard about are systems that people have extracted. And we heard from Philip about how, you know, that's the scientific method, is to extract systems. But we can also, you know, ecologists try and examine systems more holistically. And I think we can use genomics to do that, and should be doing that. I see there's a value in using genomics as a tool for some holistic analysis. DNA is everywhere. Life sheds DNA, and it's surprisingly stable. It's sort of designed to be stable. It obviously does break. You know, we all know DNA fragments, but still, it can last a very long time. And we can sequence DNA from soil and water and ice and air and essentially anywhere. There was a very nice paper a few years ago of, I think it was in Germany actually, of a filter and in a zoo, and just finding out what was in the zoo by collecting on a filter from the air and sequencing it. So it's a way to quantitatively sample life in the wild at huge data rates, and all sorts of applications. But I'm particularly going to ask the question, how far, you know, I'm interested in evolutionary genomics. How far can we look back into the past and directly assay ecosystem change and species evolution? And people, you know, have been doing this and have been using metabarcoding approaches, PCR of ITS or CO1 or whatever, to look at what species are present. And it's, you know, surprisingly quantitative, and you can calibrate that. And it's sensitive and quantitative. But we've also been pushing what's called metagenomics, which is essentially shotgun sequencing of anything, whatever there is there. And of course, that's more heavy in amount of DNA content, but you also get more information. So, you know, we heard, so I think, you know, both things are valuable. For instance, in the sponge study we just heard about, there may well be variation in the bacterial sequences in which you're not seeing just by looking at the 16S. Okay, so you can get ancient DNA. Well, so you can't really get it from air. I mean, who knows how old it is, but it's going to be dominated by modern air, and the same with water, but actually from sediments in many situations, or there are plenty of situations where it's deposited in a sequential form. So in some sense, there are dated layers. So particularly late cores are really good sources. They're thermostable, pretty thermostable, anoxic, often stratified. And there's pictures here of coring in the summer, which is the sort of standard way you think about lakes. But actually, the best way to core lakes is in winter, because you can just go out on the ice in places where it freezes over, and it's a very stable platform. You can drill down and obtain cores. And cave floors are another location. I'm going to talk about examples of both. Of course, ancient DNA is fragmented, tens of bases long. We say 30 to 100 bases often, but actually, of course, there are smaller pieces, but 30 bases is about the practical limit for having sufficient information to use. It's that much. Once you've got 30 bases, you've got 2 to the 60 bits, which is 10 to the 18 things, which is plenty of information to locate something in the space of genomic sequence. It's degraded. You get deamination at the free ends that break off. That's got pros and cons. It means that it's not exactly what it was when it started, but also that's a signature which you can use to get some confidence that at least this isn't brand new modern DNA. And that's a useful QC thing. Also, it's very low concentration and sparse, but it is sequenceable and it's usable, and you just have to sequence more of it. And sequencing is getting cheaper all the time. So the first data set I'm going to talk about. So I've been collaborating with S.K. Welleslev, who's been one of the pioneers and drivers of these sorts of studies. And I've had several people in the group have worked on new methods for analyzing data and some of the data sets that he and his collaborators have developed. And I'm going to give three examples. And then I'm going to talk a bit about, if I have time, where we're going with the other task of providing a reference for life. So the first data set is this one of Arctic permafrost. We have 535 sediment samples from 74 sites circling the Arctic, as you can see. The permafrost, there are these little holes you might see here, and he's got a device that basically drills into the side. So, you know, it's key about thing about permafrost is if you go in sufficiently far, it may thaw, the surface may thaw in the summer, but you don't have to go all that far in, and it's frozen in, it's always been frozen off for a very long time. And if it was deposited on the surface and then froze, there's good chances of very good preservation. So this was published in 2021, I think. Okay. So questions for this, what did the Arctic vegetation look like? And we can look back over at least 50,000 years across this whole circumpolar region. So what did it look like globally and regionally? How did vegetation change in response to climate change? It's a big topic of interest now, but we can actually look at very dramatic climate changes over that time period. And then there's a key question that people are interested in. You know, we know that there were all these megafauna. How did they, where were they, and how did they go extinct? And there's been a hypothesis for a long time that it was human hunting that led to that. But, you know, there's been also an alternative view that really it was climate change that did in for the mammoths and the woolly rhinoceroses and so on. Okay, so we can maybe at least inform that discussion, if not answer it. So if we first look, if we take these data sets and we collect shotgun samples and we map them to a reference database, so that in itself was a picture, can I say yes? We have a reference database here of, actually, my notes say 1.5 million organisms. I think that's an awful lot. I suspect there's a sort of named units in NCBI or something, which possibly aren't all as separate, as distinct as possible, but certainly in the hundreds of thousands, which is the space of items with sequence in the databases. We also, though, importantly and interestingly for this study, added 1,500 modern circumpolar plants, which were not very well sequenced, but did collect shotgun sequence. And that made a big difference to the analysis. We're going to come back to that. Having references, because the reference resources is incredibly patchy now and very, very incomplete, almost fully incomplete. And that's a limit. Most things don't map to anything. Of course, there's lots of microbial. We don't have a complete, you know, reference to the microbial world. But, you know, as a genomic person, I think it's got to be finite. It should be, that's not an unattainable thing. We should think about that. Okay, so plants first. We've got these 1,500 plants where we can be pretty confident that these are sort of the common plants, at least, that are circumpolar from people who know. And so we can do a reasonable job. There's a wide range, and we can look across time. So we're going from pre-last glacial maximum. So here we have time running on this axis. This is the 20 to 25,000 years ago, the LGM. Glacial maximum. This is temperature dropping here and then rising again. This is the Younger Dryas at about 12,000 years ago, for those who know it. Both temperature goes up, but also precipitation goes up. So precipitation actually sort of follows temperature surprisingly closely. So those are things that are quite dramatic, and we're looking at a 20 degree temperature change here. So there's big changes. Interestingly, so this is different types of plant. So these are herbaceous, And what we know and we knew already was there was this sort of mammoth steppe tundra, which dominated before the last glacial maximum. These are woody plants. And there was a big crossover after the LGM, big drop in grassland, some sort of fluctuation since. And this is Shannon diversity. This is the diversity. And actually it was increasing through the ice ages and was higher then than now, and dropped precipitously in this period. So there were big changes. These are sort of global. There was persistence of the steppe tundra in northern Siberia, northern central Siberia. And so there's a plants, then we can start looking at animals. We find, you might think animals are rare. You might think it's not surprising we find plants, but animals are rare. But we find material in a large number of sites for woolly rhinoceros, bison, horse, caribou, hare, wolf, vole, and some other things, but these are the most common. The megafauna distribution shrank progressively over time. In some ways, this is unbiased. You know, our measurements up till now have been based on finding fossils. It's quite hard work to find fossils. People look in certain places, so it's patchy. This is a sort of unbiased assessment because, of course, I mean, it's not totally uniformly sampled, but we could sample. And in many cases, the eDNA records, in fact, I think in almost for things that went extinct, record more recent survival than previous fossil evidence. So we see horses in North America, you know, 8,000 years ago rather than 12,000 years ago, which is the last documented fossils. We see woolly rhinoceros 10 rather than 14. So the dates you get from fossils are just, you know, upper bounds on the last date, of course, because you don't see the, and they still are for what we find. And mainland mammoths, there was a story that they went extinct on the mainland about 10,000 years ago. And then on Wrangel Island, which is an island off the north of northeast Siberia, that was where the last mammoths were found about 4,000 years ago. But actually we find eDNA evidence for mammoths about the same time, 4,000 years ago, on the mainland. So that turns over this view that they only managed to survive on the island because maybe the people couldn't get at them and they were left alone there. So megafauna persistence correlates with regional variation in vegetation. These are pictures of different types of vegetation in different places. They're fairly different. And in fact, you can see that in Siberia, it sort of stays more stable than elsewhere. But it's suggestive of habitat change being a primary cause of extinction rather than human hunting. I think that's the conclusion that was drawn. I have to say, I'm not the sort of paleoecologist who can weigh all the arguments, but I think that this is consistent with a view of habitat change being important. So can we go further than that? And we're doing this whole genome stuff. And if we just wanted to say what's present, we could probably do that with meta barcoding. So 136 of the 535 samples mapped reads to the mammoth genome. We've got pretty good mammoth genomes because they preserve well. And 104 mapped to the mammoth mitochondrion with a mean of about 9 reads per sample. And that's more than the number of previously sequenced mammoth mitochondrial genomes. So we're adding to the whole set. And so can we add to our understanding of mammoth population structure? So these are different time periods. And actually these are both the triangles, the eDNA, and the circles are fossils. So I'm not, and the colors are the clade. So the mammoth population structure, at least we can look at that from the mitochondrial point of view. There are quite deeply branching clades several hundred thousand years ago separated. So there were really, you know, distinct mammoth strands of which went, you know, serially actually replaced each other to some extent. Okay, so we can do that. We can take these samples and we can place them into a reference phylogeny of 78 published samples. There's about 650 informative SNPs, variable sites. They form as a tree. There's a tree here. We developed a new method, Pathfinder. So I'm a bioinformatician and statistician to do this. And it was actually originally developed for the human Y chromosome to place, you know, low sample human samples into the Y or mitochondrial phylogeny, but you can apply it to mammoths. And in fact, you're going to see more of these pictures. And the way it works is it It looks for sites which are mutated on one of the on the various branches of the tree. Of course, there's a tree, and the way you build the tree, and the reason why we can see it. But what happens is there are mutations that happen on the branches, and you can ask: Does your sample happen to have cover a read from your sample cover a site which is variable? And then you can ask: Does it agree with the derived version on that strand? It doesn't because it's red, but it does agree with the derived version on this strand, and it does agree all the way down to here. So that's a specific example where we can place a single sample here. And actually, there's something quite interesting about this. It suggests that in our eDNA sample, which came out of a little bit of a core, we've actually sampled a single mammoth, because we don't often get things which place in two very widely different places. We're going to come back to that. So we get lots of new clade examples at new locations. These are all barcodes of these different clades, 1C, 1DE. These are the different major subgroups. And as I said, sometimes we find the most recent example of a clade, or we find things, clades, in places where they hadn't been observed before. There's a specific example here that's interesting, because it looks like there's some samples which branch off very deep here. So these are the main things. Here's an example of the most recent clade 2, which was thought to go extinct about 40,000 years ago, and we have extended that by 10,000 years. But here we have some samples which are 27 SNPs which don't agree with anything. So it has private variants at 27 sites, which suggests, and the last place it joins is right here at this branch, suggesting there's a whole clade which has not been previously observed, which maybe was rare, but we've seen. Okay, so that's one story we can start to sort of add to our knowledge. But I guess it's an extension. Second one is Kap Copenhagen. That's a site at the very north of Greenland, which is a cold desert now. There's nothing really living there. But it was known to be fossil bearing from about 2 million years old. They're drilling cores from these fossil bearing layers. It's believed to be estuarine low-lying land. The fossils, interestingly, haven't yielded very much in the way of DNA. There's been quite a big effort to find it. Of course, it's very old, because up until last year, nobody had published any DNA, ancient DNA older than a million years. From the eDNA samples, there were about 35 different libraries made. Of course, you're actually sampling, it's all very compressed. So you're sampling probably tens of thousands of years here. It's not, you can't think of it as a single ecosystem that you're sampling, and that's sort of, quite a lot might have happened in that time. But this is looking back when the whole world was warmer. There was the Pliocene about 4 million years ago. Actually, the world was warmer, I think, than it is now and is going to be even. So, or depends how bad it gets, but certainly warmer than it is now. It was still warm in that time. So these are mapping to plants again. You know, we see a whole set of things. There's some variation systematically between these different units. What we see is a mixed boreal woodland and mixture of a sort of boreal woodland and Arctic ecosystem. Actually, it doesn't correspond to any modern ecosystem. There are 102 genera found, 40, many of them are not found in Greenland today. There are 40 that are now found in North America, some that are extinct. There are 24 that weren't, there's no evidence before from this site, which has been very heavily investigated in terms of pollen and fossils. So we're seeing we're seeing things that hadn't been discovered before that fit. And there's another 40. So the majority where they have been seen as fossils of pollen, but the quality has not been good enough to assign them to even to genus level, let alone species. So, there's still issues about assigning to species. And in fact, at that time, distance. What a species, you know, whether things are the same species or not isn't totally well defined. So these are plants, and then these are animals. We're seeing geese, caribou, lemmings, probably, Elephantidae, we'll come back to those, and rabbits and so on, various different things. There was a sort of very fanciful picture created of what this world that we can't see in the modern world might have looked like. And you might notice that these have got curly, what do you call them? Tusks. That's sorry, mental block, which is not what the not the same as the woolly mammoths. And these are actually not mammoths; they're mastodons. So mammoths are down here. Mammoths are actually relatives of Indian elephants. They're more closely related to Indian elephants than Indian elephants are to African elephants. But mammoths are a much more distant thing. And there was no idea that mammoths had been present in Greenland previously to this. They basically, I think, a North American species. So that was unique. And certainly in this sort of habitat also. So there's a whole lot of new information there. So one thing we did there, you know, it's been geologically dated, but obviously it's important to get as much confirmation that this is really old DNA as possible, and it didn't get in there somehow by some other route, is ask whether we could molecularly date from the sequence. So Bianca De Sanctis, who is my student, looked at this. So there's a lot of coverage of certain plants, betula, birch, willow, populus also. So in this case, we had 24 coverage of the chloroplast. Of course, for plants, there's a lot of chloroplasts. Chloroplasts are quite big, the genomes. So it's actually quite nice for mapping. There's quite a lot of information there. And there was a consistent placing in the tree for these. So presumably this wasn't just from one, because we're combining across all the data sets from a single individual. But they fall here, which is actually outside this whole big set of things here, which I think have got multiple species named in them. So we're getting some evolutionary picture of, it's now old enough to be outside this. And given that, we can ask in a couple of different ways whether that the data are consistent with it being 2 million years old. So we can look at where it branches off from the main branch, and we can measure the length of that branch. And we've got decent numbers here, 29 SNPs on one side and 30 on the other side variants. And we can estimate the depth of the tree below that, and we can estimate the length of the private branch where we have enough coverage. And if we do that and we take, this plus this minus this, we get an estimate of the age of the, in terms of mutation, the mutational clock of the, this sample, and we get a 2.2 million year estimate between about 1 and 4 million with 95% confidence interval. We can also use a Bayesian approach in BEAST. There's various ways to partition things. You can get slightly different numbers. This is not the very best of them, but they're pretty, it gives a lower estimate, but one that just includes two as a boundary. So maybe it's a bit less than two. Certainly, I think it's reasonable to say, with all the other evidence, that it's well over a million, probably towards two. It's consistent with being 2 million years old, which is what the geologists believe. So you might say this is one data point. We know that specific single trees are very noisy and erratic. Can we use other data points from other species? Well, there is, as I said, lots of data from other samples. Actually, there's more data from Salix. And carex, sedges, there's a lot of data. The trouble is that we get very complex signals there. We get all sorts of green and red on these pictures where, so there are probably multiple species over multiple times, and kind of working out what's going on is difficult. And I think that's going to be important to sort of deconvolute mixtures. And we have made some progress in that. And the best example of it is here. So this is a cave in Mexico, very different environment, hot and dry. But it is a cave, so it's cooler and stable inside. And the reason for interest in this cave is that there was a lithic suggestion, these things that look very like worked flint or worked stone. So that's, again, not my expertise, even further from my expertise. So I'm not going to evaluate this. It got into high reputation journals, being careful to be DORA compliant.
You all recognize the font.
So, and if true, that would make it, you know, revolutionary in terms of human occupation of the Americas. So there was a lot of interest in getting human DNA. So there was an enormous amount of effort in white suits to collect samples. They sequenced 59 samples. Unfortunately, there was no evidence for ancient humans, but there was lots of evidence of ancient bears. And in particular, there was evidence of two types of bear about 16,000 years ago, actually in the same deposits and in some other samples around them. So American black bear, which is a familiar thing to some of you who, from camping in the American West. And then this thing, which is not familiar because it's extinct, but is the biggest bear that's ever lived, Arctodus similis, giant short-faced bear. So here it is, on its 4 feet, human-sized, but standing up, it would be very scary. So we can see evidence of both mitochondria, as we see here. So this is the sort of clean version. There's one bit of noise here, but there's a very, the reference resources are better here. So we can, we're pretty confident. And we can also map data to the whole autosomal genomes. So there was a draft genome for Arctodus, actually co-published with this ancient sample from Alaska, from an Alaskan version. And so this cave comes from down here. There's three different samples from three different places and time points in the cave, all in the range of 12 to 20,000 years ago. And in some sense, you know, in terms of modern properties, it's more like the West and geographically closer to these Western samples. So there'd been a study of diversity in American black bears in which there was a clear Western clade and a sort of Eastern grouping. So the hypothesis was originally that this was going to look like the Western samples. But actually on a PCA plot, you can see they're more close to the Eastern samples. And then what happens is there's a sort of third axis, which is the modern Alaskan samples. So the model here is that maybe what happened is that during the Ice Age, the original pre-LGM population of bears was all across the Americas. There's a kind of grassland belt, which is not good habitat for them. These are black bears, they're woodland animals. And that in the Ice Age, as it came down, it pushed them into refugia, which are southwest and southeast. And that actually this Mexican was more connected to the southeast. And then when the expansion went back, these came back and reconnected and gave rise with drift to in fact, it was the Eastern contributed the most to the Alaskan, the modern Alaskan component. Okay, so I've now got a minute left, it says, but I'm going to use a few of them. We need reference genomes for doing all these things. So Jim, what I hope I've got across to you is, you know, there's all sorts of opportunities to get at interesting things in the past, but we need reference genomes, and they are limiting for what we can do. We'd like to look at microbial interactions as well, for example. So permafrost studies benefited from plant references, but they did suffer from draft quality. That was an issue. The Arctodus draft genome was co-published, and we also had an Andean spectacled bear, which we used and was important because that was a good modern reference. It's hard to study ancient microbial environment because modern genomic reference is missing and poor. It's also true that microbes can persist or invade. There are these stories about resurrecting microbes from permafrost. I'm not sure, it's not implausible, but I don't know about that. But luckily, new long read technologies are enabling high quality de novo reference genomes to be constructed. And you know, there's really a revolution going on in this. And a few years ago, a set of people led by Harris Lewin and John Kress and Gene Robinson, proposed this Earth Biogenome Project. And they said, we should think in terms of sequencing all the species in the next 10 years. And that seems a very grandiose thing, but it's also a very kind of, that's the way that one needs to think or can think in genomics. So there was this PNAS paper from 5 years ago. But if we think about it, you know, there are about 1,000 done already. At twofold increase per year, we could expect to sequence 2 to the 10 in 10 years. That's 1,000-fold more than that. That would be, you know, 1 million. And there are only 1.5 million named eukaryotic species. Now, we all know that there are more species than are named, but still it would be good going to get to that point. And, you know, and we can start to, and I think we'll learn a huge amount about this, and that we can connect modern molecular genetics to our interactions with the whole living world. We can provide new models for gene function. We can study ecology in an unbiased fashion, as I've been hinting about. It's important for conservation. That's important now, biodiversity evaluation and conservation, understanding species and population structure clearly would help us understand better speciation and evolution. And also for bioengineering, I think it's really important just to have examples, be able to move into different systems and look at examples of biomolecular systems. So within that, kind of from where I'd been starting up at the Sanger Institute, led a project that called the Darwin Tree of Life Project, that's its logo, that aimed to sequence, had the goal of doing this for all the eukaryotic species of Britain and Ireland. And that may seem a bit insular, and it's unfortunate it happens around all this Brexit nonsense, but it's actually is you know, there's multiple reasons why it's good to start with your own community. Actually, some of the things that came up, you know, and there's an interesting debate to have, which we're very much part of. And in fact, Maui Hudson, you had on the list, that I've talked a lot with in this area. To start with your own community, in some sense, is natural. It's very well studied. We can work with the national resources, the Natural History Museum, the Royal Botanic, the Kew Gardens, the Marine Biology Lab, who sort of have national knowledge and national resources. We don't have problems, legal problems of moving between places, or problems of who owns what rights to what, or we can deal with those, and we can form a collective consortium. And it's very important that, because getting the samples is the challenge for this, actually. It's not ultimately the sequencing, it's going to be getting the samples and doing that in a reasonable, you know, ethically sound way. We're very embedded in, there's now ERGA, European Reference Genome Atlas, which is essentially establishing this infrastructure across Europe and working both to establish and standards and facilitate the creation of projects of all different types in different places. So Mark Blackster is head of this. So here's our progress to date. Actually, that slide is from last year when there were 1,500 species in progress and 370 genomes submitted. But we've got protists, a few, obviously there are more of those, but you know, plants, bryophytes and flowering plants, fungi, these are all animals. These are chordates, slightly overrepresented, I think, but not very. Various annelids and mollusks. And then these, I think, are all arthropods. So we've got an insects here. So we see, as you saw earlier, Diptera, beetles. There's actually a lot of caddisflies here and a lot of Lepidoptera. So that was last June. We did get held up by the pandemic. That was not good for collection and collaboration and establishment of large-scale efforts. But by April this year, there was about double submitted, and there's another 360 with complete data. So there's actually over 1,000 now sequenced with complete data. And in fact, there's 1,000 completed, but not yet in the EBI. There's actually 159 where we'd submitted them to the EBI and they haven't got out in the public domain yet. So there are buffers at lots of places. But there's 2,000 with some data, so there's another 2,000 coming. Overall, And overall, there's 3,000 odd species from 850 families. Oh yeah, something I wanted to say here is, although Britain is, it's actually rather impoverished biodiversity-wise, we have 4% of global species, named species, but it's quite representative. There are 40% of families and 70% of orders. So even though there's only 4% of species, we can cover 40% of families. Of course, we share most of our biodiversity with the rest of Europe. So, right. Yeah, okay. It's going down again. I've got some. Okay, I'll stop then soon. Okay, well, here's one that assembled with one gap. 29 chromosomes. It's a that assembled with there's just one gap, telomere to telomere for 28 of 29 chromosomes from scratch. We've improved, that doesn't always happen. This is one with lots of bits when we assembled it and scaffolded it the old way, but we've improved all the technology. So here's a new scaffolder that gives you all the chromosomes. This is the X chromosome that's at half depth. There's an error here for those who can read these things. It should not look like that, but that's not so bad. So actually what we do is we do all this automatically and then we have somebody fix the blatant errors. And of course, if you had to fix the blatant errors at this stage, that would be a lot of work, but we're just working all the time to streamline things so that we can automate. That's the way of doing these things. Okay. This is mistletoe. This was a sort of challenge. We thought we would get 100 gigabase genome. Unfortunately, it ended up at 99.5 gigs, which was very sad. This is the automated assembly. This is after a bit of human work. Yeah, there's a bit of stuff here which isn't yet sorted out, but most of it is in chromosomes. You see this wonderful checkerboard structure. That's biology. That's the way that there are these huge chromosomes that are, you know, 10 gigs long, the size of three whole human genomes, and they're folded back on themselves and lined up in some fashion. So you get high C signals, which are form this cross and which form crosses with all the other chromosomes. So that's the organization of these enormous chromosomes in the nucleus. Symbionts, you're all interested in symbionts. These are, we get them. We actually sometimes get these bizarre, you know, protozoan symbionts in fish tissue and so on. But particularly these are Wolbachia. There's 110 Wolbachia genomes here. These are the supergroups of Wolbachia, and these are different insect orders. And you can see that they don't sort phylogenetically. There's all sorts of interesting information about, you know, there's some consistency here about what's going on in detail. There's a very nice paper by Emmeline Lancaster with Mark about that. And so conclusions, advances in sequencing technology show no sign of slowing. There are new opportunities. We can look at the ecosystems and we can provide reference genomes. We can start to look back in time from ancient eDNA, not just at species presence, but also at changes in genetic variation and population substructure. It's achievable, and I think because it's achievable, it's inevitable that we will get comprehensive references. I would like to see that happen. It's still a challenge, and that will facilitate ecosystem analysis. It'll sort of democratize, you know, equilibrate what we can do, and we need microbial bacterial coverage, but I think there are metagenomic studies and there are approaches which are doing this. I think we're going to get there, and there are plans underway. Actually, yes, a proposal just got submitted today for a consortium to map ecosystems across Holocene Northern Europe. That's since in the last 10,000 years, and do some other things as well. But the aim is to get late core DNA from places near human settlements to study the ice age, you know, how our whole environment has changed and how our crops have changed over the last 10,000 years. I will stop there. I want to credit Bianca, in particular, who did a lot of the ancient eDNA analysis. And these are key people from geogenetics with SK at the bottom. Thanks.